Well, good evening to you. You're watching Newsline Prime on TV One. We have a new face on our show this evening, Mr. Rasika Jayakodi, who is a political analyst. We are going to talk to Mr. Rasika Jayakodi about several topics that have come to the limelight in the past few weeks, so to say. We are going to talk to him about the garbage issue, especially the waste containers found at the CICT and in the Khatnaika Free Trade Zone. We are of course going to talk to him about the working committee meeting of the United National Party today and the upcoming presidential election. So let's get right to it. Mr. Jayakodi, thank you very much for agreeing to be a part of our show. We hope to see you more on our network in the future as well. Let me straight away get to the topic. Today, the working committee of the United National Party met. There were a lot of anticipation from the United National Party members, party loyalists, that there will be sort of a change in this whole direction and that there will be a new face. To be very plain about it, Sajith Premadasa will be announced as the presidential candidate. However, what we saw was completely different. We saw a proposal, a proposed constitution for a new alliance being put forward. We see 10 or 12 people who have spoken for this proposal. And the working committee saying, no, this is not the way to move forward. The working committee of the United National Party has to have the power here, and this being rejected. So that is what we are, that is what we saw today during the day. So all of this, coming back to a step behind and checking and looking at what's going on, is the United National Party going in the right direction, first of all? And second of all, will the party loyalists, the party voters, get what they are asking for?
Chaturanga, thank you for inviting me. I think the hype around the UNP working committee meeting was mainly created by the media. That's what I see. Because I think it all happened because the UNP is now trying to form a common alliance with several other affiliated organizations. And earlier there were remarks that this alliance would be agreement will be signed on August 5th.
Yes.
Because of that, today everyone anticipated that some key decisions will be made at the working committee meeting chaired by Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe. However, from what we hear and from what is being reported, it's now clear that the working committee has apparently decided to form the alliance in principle. Yep. I mean, in principle they have agreed to form the alliance. But there are some doubts about the constitution of the proposed alliance and how the power structure will be formed. Mm. And then there are also, from what I see on Facebook and social media, there are doubts about the date of signing the final agreement. Some say it will be signed on August 5th, and some say even Dr. Harshini Silva tweeted that that there's no final decision on the date. So these are these confusions and conflicting reports are there, but I think the UNP is the election is due in early December, and we're still in July, and we have 5 months to go. And I don't see the rationale in announcing the candidate at this point, because the element, if they are fielding a new candidate, the element of surprise should be there. So then they can't create the surprise if they announce the candidate 5 months before the election. That's not how it works. Now, if you remember now the last presidential election in 2015, the candidate was announced 7 weeks before the election. So there's an element of surprise.
Absolutely.
And the opposition, I mean, the Rajapaksha group, UPFA, at that point, they couldn't strategize. I mean, they went into a different zone because they didn't know how to deal with this development. How politics works. So I don't think it's a wise move for the UNP to announce their candidate at this point. I mean, it doesn't make any sense in terms of political strategy. But there's a lot of expectation on the part of the media and the party supporters, because, you know, I think it's natural. It's a natural scenario. The people and politics runs on hope. So that explains everything.
Yeah. Mr. Jayakodi, again, now, the United National Party's working committee, as you said, received a lot of attention from the media. For the past few days, a document was circulating on social media, and even mainstream print and electronic media also touched on it. A document supposedly showing a renunciation certificate of the citizenship of Gotabaya Rajapaksa. Now, this we know now that it's confirmed that it was a fake document. But the necessity to create something like that brings us to a whole different point. Now, we know that in 2015 the presidential election depended a lot on the social media aspect. And right now we are seeing a tendency in the social media to move towards a lot of fake news and to base the policies on those fake news items. Because I'm talking about this because as soon as this document was published on social media, even the print media, the politicians, the whole country, in fact, looked at it and, you know, sort of went with it. So this trend that you are seeing on social media, if you agree with me, how do you view this?
I mean, it's like that all over the world because social media has disrupted the entire media landscape. And I mean, social media has become the media.
Yeah.
I mean, to tell you the truth, I know people in the mainstream media are reluctant to accept this, but that's the reality that we have to deal with. And especially Sri Lankans, they still don't know, they still haven't figured this out, in my opinion. They have very low social media literacy. And especially when it comes to understanding the authenticity of a story or something that they see or hear on social media. But in terms of Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksha's letter, he himself confirmed that it's a fake document, but today a Sinhala newspaper carried the original Maubima newspaper carried the original letter, and I think Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksha's official spokesman also confirmed, and he tweeted the letter. I saw it in the evening. So now it's clear that Mr. Gotabaya Rajapaksha has renounced his US citizenship. That means he's getting ready to run for the election, and that was expected, I think, in their camp. There's a lot of expectation, and everyone, I mean, almost everyone wanted Mr. Rajapaksha to run because they perceived him as the next best choice after former president, official leader Mahinda Rajapaksha. But there's another interesting point, Chaturanga. Now, in terms of Mr. Rajapaksha's citizenship, now, 19th Amendment to the Constitution prevented dual citizens from running for the presidency, right?
Yes.
But interestingly, the 19th Amendment, the Presidential Election Act of Sri Lanka, is yet to be amended in line with the 19th Amendment to the Constitution, right? And then, the elections commissioner, the elections
chairman of the elections commissioner,
chairman of the elections commissioner can't check whether a candidate is a dual citizen at the time of giving him the nomination to run for the election.
Right.
So technically, as far as I know, Mr. Rajapaksha can still run for the election even without this letter from the US. So he can still run for the election, but anyone who has a problem with his candidacy will have to challenge it after the election. They have to take the Geeta Kumara Singha route, and that will take some time. So very interesting dynamics from what I see, but now it's clear that Mr. Rajapaksha will run for the election, and I think the Sri Lanka Podujana Peramuna is now getting ready to announce his candidacy. Some of them, even their key spokespersons, have made it clear that they will make the final announcement on August 11th at the National Convention of the party. Again, the same dynamics I explained earlier
apply
come into play.
Yeah.
So I don't know why they are trying to do it at this point, like 5 months before the election. So let's see.
Thank you, Mr. Dakodi, for that. And we also have to understand, like the United National Party's candidate and the Working Committee and Prime Minister Ranil Wickremesinghe announcing who their candidate will be, here too, Mahinda Rajapaksa's role, former president and opposition leader Mahinda Rajapaksa's role when it comes to the candidate is vital, as they claim. They want Mahinda Rajapaksa to announce who their candidate will be. So, as Mr. Dakodi said, 5th of August or on a future date, 11th August, we will see who the candidates are from the two main political camps. We are yet to know what the SLFP-SLPP agreement is going to be or what they decide. So that is where we stand in terms of the presidential election as of right now and from the updates that we have. But obviously, time will tell what will happen, and we will keep you updated. I want to quickly move from this topic to several other points that I want to talk to Mr. Jayakodi about. Mr. Jayakodi, now, everyone seems to be aware of the garbage containers, the waste containers. We touched on it on our intro as well. And for the past few weeks, we've seen several updates. We've seen a Court of Appeal issuing an injunction order, notices being issued to the respondents, then several stakeholders having press conferences. We've seen for the first time a person representing one of the companies coming out and speaking. So a lot has been happening in the past few weeks. My question to you is, yes, this incident has taken place. Yes, it's a vital and a very disappointing situation in terms of the country's security and the environmental security. But the failure of the state institutions, be the customs, be the CEA, be the Ministry of International Trade and the BOI, all of these institutions have an equal responsibility to tackle something like this. What do you think of the failure of the state institutions?
Chaturanga, this incident reminds me of DC Archie's Manik Malla, right? So we are dealing with hundreds of containers full of garbage, and they are parked at they're at Kalamb Port and some of the mine Katunayaka. But apparently no one has brought them down, right? There's no one to take ownership, right? I mean, did they land from the sky or somewhere? This is a serious problem. Yeah. But it looks like a farce, I know, but beyond that, there's a tragic aspect to this. I mean, there's an institutional framework in this country, right? There's the BOI, there's the Central Environmental Authority, CEA, and there are many other players, state actors, handling this process.
Yeah.
Now, I watched your Face the Nation show earlier this week, and Mr. Jagat Gunawardena clearly explained that the importation of garbage is strictly prohibited under the National Environmental Act, which it is very clear. There are some discrepancies in terms of, what's there in the CEA website and all that, but the law, from what I understood, the law governing the current situation is the National Environmental Act. So, if some party has actually imported those garbage containers, I mean, they have violated the country's law. And now it's clear that they have been operating under the BOI regulations, right? The BOI has permitted them to engage in business, import these containers, whatever. It's interesting as to why the BOI, is it the duty of the BOI to turn a blind eye? Just issue a license blindly and then look the other way.
Yeah,
it doesn't. From what I understand, it doesn't work that way.
Absolutely.
Right? There has to be some regulatory mechanism. There has to be some review process. See, BOI should have a mechanism to figure out what these guys are doing after obtaining the license. Otherwise, much worse things can happen in this country if we go down this path.
Absolutely.
So where's the responsibility? Mm. Right. So and now even the Central Environment Authority, the BOI. They issue, post-fiasco chest-thumping statements, but that doesn't mean anything to the public.
Yeah.
The public, these institutions are run by the taxpayers. Even the poorest segments of our society pay for these institutions, so they have a responsibility to perform.
Absolutely.
Right?
Yep.
So these institutions have made a mockery of the system. That's what I understand. And even the Central Environmental Authority, right? So they got activated after the incident.
Yeah.
But people expect a proactive approach from all these institutions. They have to investigate. We don't know how long this has been happening.
Yeah.
Right? How many garbage containers have been dumped in Sri Lanka?
Absolutely.
Right. And there are reports that there are human organs and clinical waste. So all these things, and there are numerous health hazards, right? And then the health aspect is not being covered at all.
Yeah.
Right? And the health ministry has a responsibility to step in and conduct a thorough investigation. But unfortunately, in Sri Lanka, even the teaching hospitals don't have the necessary, antibiotics and other necessary medical items. So in a country like that, I can't expect the health ministry stepping in and, taking a proactive approach and, investigating these matters.
Yeah.
So it's a very, it's an unbelievable situation.
Mr. Jayakuri, now I want to draw your attention to this as well. Now, on Monday, you said you watched our program. We heard a superintendent of the customs coming before us and saying that these investigations commenced as a part of a green Sri Lanka program that they were carrying out. But yesterday, in fact, I was seated at a press conference where another customs deputy director said something else altogether. We were told that the CICT had launched an investigation, asked the customs to inspect these containers because there was stench emanating from the containers. So again, the state institution, same state institution, two different officials coming before the media, coming before the general public and saying two different things.
Yeah. All this time I thought the customs department was standing on the right side of the issue. Now your statement, I think it made me reconsider my position.
Same here, because initially the customs said Sri Lanka is not a garbage dump. Yeah. They said we are going to send this back. They launched an investigation. They released the items to the media, the footage. So there was some sort of confidence in the customs, yeah. But we are now also questioning the actions of the customs, mainly because the initial investigation was launched, the initial report was on the 5th of May 2019, and this was reported in the media in July of 2019. So for 2 or 1.5 months, we did not know what happened. So we have to also question the customs and their role in this when we are moving forward. But moving away from that, you bring us to an interesting point. We see a situation, Mr. Jayakodi, that politics go hand in hand with the corruption, and that's a statement everyone knows, almost a cliche. But my question to you is, we've seen one of the companies that has been named in this and a director of the company being the son of the former chairman of the Ceylon Central Environmental Authority. We see a relative of the minister in charge of the MODSE, the Ministry of International Development Strategies and International Trade, also being in the board of one of these companies. We see a very strong political hand in all of this in the time frame that the approval was granted, in the time that these things actually went through. So now coming back and saying we are not involved or we did not know about it, will that suffice before the general public and especially before the law?
Not really, because Chaturanga, that directs us to the larger question. I mean, there's no culture of accountability in Sri Lanka. Nobody is held accountable to the actions, right? Okay, theoretically, we can't prevent a person from taking up a position in a private company just because he's a relative of a minister.
Absolutely. Right?
So
yes,
we have to come to that point. But when they make a critical decision such as this, at least they should have the decency to step down from the at least distance themselves from the decision-making process, or at least disclose their biases and show some accountability.
Not wait till the media points it out.
Yeah, show some decency. That's what the public expect, right? As I told you, in Sri Lanka, the biggest problem in Sri Lanka is that our institutional framework has taken a severe beating and it's broken down, right? So because of that, it's a form of impunity, actually. It has created a smoke screen where anyone can come and do anything and get away with the repercussions.
Yeah.
So that's what we see in this instance. And there's another problem that I see in this, and we forgot to probably touch upon it during our previous segment. There's no consistency in terms of policy, right?
Mm.
For instance, now CAA website says something, and CAA website contradicts what's there in the
law.
Right, and I think one of the speakers who spoke on your show on Monday pointed out that all these state policies have not been incorporated into law, right? So they don't really mean anything, right? So there are serious institutional issues in this country that need to be rectified. But the problem is our politicians are busy looking for presidential candidates and they're running after day-to-day political, developments, micro issues without focusing on the macro side of it.
Absolutely.
Right? So that's the crisis we are in.
Interestingly, Mr. Jayakodi, you bring us to an interesting point. Today was a working committee, obviously, and we had to speak to several members of the United National Party to get information. And what we understood was the fact that a majority of UN peers were inside the temple trees while the meeting was going on. However, this was not seen in previous instances. In fact, I do not think whether the United National Party or the government had a meeting with regard to the garbage issue, but several other instances, even when several important bills were debated in parliament, we did not see the ruling party being that much of members of the ruling party being inside the parliament even. So it's understood that when it comes to problems that are worrying them or problems that are problematic to them, they gather up whole discussions, especially during the 52-day constitutional crisis. We saw this. We saw United National Party members actually staying at the temple trees to protect the Prime Minister's position. So things like that, doesn't this give a negative image to the people? Obviously, yes, the people understand what's going on, but internationally as well, the international example is also not good when we do things like this. What is your opinion?
Yeah, because there's an unbridgeable gap between the aspirations of the public and the aspirations of our politicians, right? So that is one problem. And that's not confined to the UNP.
Yeah.
Even the SLPP,
yes, correct,
is no different to that, because now we saw how they operated when it came to the Easter Sunday attacks, and they, both sides were utterly responsible.
Mm.
Right, I mean, all of the entire parliament was utterly responsible when it came to the post Easter Sunday developments.
Absolutely.
Right, so the problem here is that there has to be some kind of transparency in our institution, even in our political parties.
Mm.
So when there's a working committee meeting, you can't leave your supporters in the dark about the outcome of the of the meeting. I know there are certain political realities that we have to take into consideration. There's no argument over that. But mm. still, there has to be an official spokesperson coming up with, like an official version of in terms of what the outcome was. Just right?
Yeah.
At least the party members who walk out of the meeting should speak in one voice.
Mm.
This kind of basic discipline or basic, some basic framework should be there in any political party. But like I don't see that in our political culture.
Definitely. Today's example is, of course, the United National Party. But you bring us once again to an important point where the United National Party and the SLPP, be it whoever is in government, and right now the United National Party, because they are in the government, there seems to be this irresponsible nature of responding to the general public when it comes to communicating these matters, when it comes to important decisions that they take, especially the US agreements. We see this example when they reach free trade agreements. We see this example. We see this example when they reach various agreements with companies for projects, for tenders. There is this absolute, almost absolute miscommunication towards the general public, who in fact voted these people in. So this lack of communication in terms of the ruling party, and yeah, as you say, the opposition as well. How do you see this?
We have to go back to a very famous Sinhala saying. It says, "Balay tiyena kota molene." When you have power, you don't have the brains.
Mm.
And when you go out of power, you suddenly get
wisdom back.
Wisdom back. So it is not unique to the UNP. It's unique to all political parties that govern this country for the past 70 odd years, right?
Mm.
Importantly, there has to be pressure from citizens. The problem in Sri Lanka is that citizens, people are not politically savvy. People are not exerting enough pressure on our institutions. So had this garbage issue happened in any other country, there would have been chaos, right? There would have been protests on the street.
Yes.
People would have raised serious concerns. In our country, no one really takes any notice of it. We hardly see anything, your media institution covered it comprehensively. But if you take like day-to-day, daily from single newspapers, what do you see? So there's no, people have a responsibility to exert pressure on politicians. Citizens drive democracy.
Mm.
That's very important. Citizens form a very important component of democracy.
Mm.
So in our country, democracy has, been paralyzed because of this, very lethargic and very inactive approach on the part of our citizens. They are also, citizens can't say, they can't blame it on the politicians and wash their hands off.
Mm.
As citizens, we all have a responsibility and we have to fulfill that.
Mm.
That's very vital at this juncture.
Mr. Jaikuri, now leaving aside all of this, we are going into the presidential election, and as you said, we might have it in December when the president declares the presidential election. But a problem that we see, the technical problem that we see here, apart from the candidates not being named, is the fact that the elections chairman or the elections commissioner coming before the media and saying that the voters list that will be used will probably be the 2018 voters list. Now, we know that about 200,000 to 500,000 children, students write A-levels every year. And then, does this mean that this, in your opinion, does this mean that these numbers will not be included in the voters list and thereafter? Now, last time, the 2015 election, we know the 6.2, 5.8 million story, where everyone was like, it was just 4 lakhs that made the difference.
Yeah.
So, here we are again coming to a decisive point where would those votes go to, sort of a question. So, in your opinion, this the factor that every election that we've had, be it the local government, the provincial councils that we have not had, and even the presidential and the general elections, we've seen some way or the other a problem with the voters list. We've seen the demarcation issue, the delimitation issue, the which system to follow, first past the post, the preferential voting. The election system in our country itself has become a problem to move forward. So, should we have a change there?
I mean, again, the failure of institutions, right? Again, the same problem. But I think, so I don't know what the technical reasons are. If it's stemming from a technical reason, then it's the responsibility of the Elections Commission to rectify it and make sure that these young voters are included in the list, because disenfranchising an important segment of our youth is not a good thing. It's not healthy for our democracy.
Yes.
Sometimes that disenfranchisement can find expression in some different ways. That will be detrimental to society. So Elections Commissioner, I'm not aware of the technical aspect of it. Maybe there's solid reason why, you know, he made
from what we know, the problem was the fact that you cannot obtain the voters registrations because of the monsoons affecting and the drought season and the floods. So there were technical reasons, in fairness to the chairman of the Election Commission, but this is a serious problem.
This is a serious problem because these are the more politically, they're very active.
Yeah.
And it's the first vote. And, you know, that makes in Sri Lanka, I think the next election will be a hotly contested one. And I think it will be, in my opinion, I think it will be quite similar to the last presidential election. Whatever said and done, there will be very, very crucial, very key, you know, very, very, very crucial fight, very crucial battle. So it's very important to include this segment, right? So we have to, I think, as citizens, again, we have to raise our voices and ensure that new voters are included. Otherwise, as I said, it can find expression in different ways and later.
Mr. Jayakodi, final few minutes of this evening's newsline, and I want to almost take a conclusion from what we spoke today. As a concluding question, let me ask you this. We are at a situation where a group of people are wanting a presidential election. A group of people were trying to get a provincial council on the board. Then some wanted to take legal action and also have a general election as well. In your opinion, as a person who's following this, as a political analyst who is in the field, where are we going, and will we actually see what is going to happen? Will we actually have a presidential election in a few months, or will there be changes?
Yeah,
there's a Supreme Court decision also pending, and there's some confusion there. What is your opinion?
Yes, I think Elections Commissioner has made clear that even if the provincial council election takes place ahead of the presidential election will take place without delay. Right? So he has made it clear. He made the statement during addressing a press conference. But I think given the political situation in the country, there's an imperative need for presidential election. You know, provincial council election will not resolve any issue, any burning issue at the time. I think there are serious doubts about the conduct of the president as well, and especially in terms of the Easter Sunday attacks and things like that. And people are expecting a presidential election. People are, I don't see, you know, people are, at this point, there were concerns about the provincial council election over the past few years. But at this point, everyone is more or less, they are more focused on presidential election. I think the presidential election will take place first, except, you know, we never know, probably the Supreme Court will give a ruling and then provincial council election will take place ahead of that. But I think all political parties have a responsibility to make sure that the presidential election is held on time. I mean, we have played with the provincial council election, we have played with, you know, the local government election, but we can't play any game with the presidential election. It is very critical. It's very crucial that it takes place on time. So all political parties, all political leaders, all citizens have a responsibility to exert pressure on the system to make sure that the presidential election takes place on time. There's no two words about it.
Prime, we spoke of several topics. It was indeed an interesting chat to have. I hope we will see more of you on our program as well, and on Face the Nation and other political programs that we are on, News First and TV1. So it's great to have you. Thank you very much. Thank you, Mr. Jayakodi, once again. With that, we will have an interesting guest tomorrow as well. And my producer tells me it's going to be another journalist and political analyst tomorrow as well. So a lot of points to speak about, a lot of facts to speak about, and there are daily updates coming in from the political arena. So in fact, we will have an interesting show tomorrow as well. So do stay tuned to TV1 at 8 p.m. tomorrow. We will join you tomorrow and next week as well, and as we keep you updated on the political situation in the country and much more. Thank you very much for watching. Have a great night.